I think we can start, Francesco. What do you think?
Yes, sure. I think it's a good time
to start.
Okay.
So, make it big. I could say a few words and then leave the floor to Atish and then Francesco for the introduction of the speaker. It's okay?
Okay.
Okay. Okay. So, it's really a pleasure to have with us, Mike Kosterlitz. I'm Stefano Ruffo, the director of SISSA. Mike is a Scottish-born theoretical physicist. He's a professor at Brown University. And Francesco will say a few words more later. Physicists have always cataloged states of matter using symmetry. The revolutionary work of Mike in the 70s introduced a surprising and unprecedented element, topology. The topological nature of matter is a bit like the rhesus factor in blood. You need to know it in order to know how different portions of matter relate to each other. The different topology of the two portions protects their existence, a feature that might lead to future applications in quantum technologies, a field where SISSA and ICTP have recently created the Collaborative Research Institute. Besides that, the topological theories of Mike are beautiful and elegant. And some say that beauty doesn't count for anything, but many in physics think that indeed beauty represents a fundamental virtue of a theory. I met Mike last year in StatFIS meeting in Buenos Aires. Mike subscribed to the conference as a standard participant and didn't announce his presence to the organizer. He has been scrupulously following several sessions and was then invited to hold a session with a young researcher. The idea of inviting him came after a very pleasant meeting I had with him and his wife in a hall of a hotel. And I hope that Mike will come soon in the future and visit our beautiful institutions, SISSA and ICTP. I leave the floor to Atish.
Okay, thank you. No, it's also a great pleasure for me to have Michael Kosterlitz for this joint series that we've been having together with SISSA. And we've had really a number of very interesting colloquia in this series. And I'm really looking forward to this random walk through physics to a Nobel Prize. And as Stefano said, we would be very happy to have the speaker visit us maybe when the situation improves sometime in the future. Thank you.
Okay, so let me say a few words to introduce today's speaker. So Professor J. Michael Kosterlitz, as Stefano says, is a British-American physicist. He was born in Scotland, son of the biochemist Hans Walter Kosterlitz. He received his Bachelor and Master of Arts degrees from the Gonville and Caius College in Cambridge. And later in 1969, he's a PhD from the University of Oxford. Then he held a couple of postdoctoral positions, in particular one at the University of Birmingham, where he collaborated with David Thouless, and one at Cornell University. And then he was appointed to the faculty of the University of Birmingham in 1974, first as a lecturer and then as a reader. And since 1992, he has been professor of physics at Brown University in the United States. Now, Professor Kosterlitz is mainly a physicist doing research in condensed matter theory. He has been interested, among other topics, in low dimensional systems and their phase transitions. And in fact, famous in particular is the Berezinskii Kosterlitz Thouless transition in two dimensional systems that they discovered. However, he is also a climber. And indeed, there is even a climbing route in the Italian Alps that bears his name. And I think we will hear more about that during his talk. Professor Kosterlitz has won several prizes and awards. Let me mention some of them. The Maxwell Medal and Prize from the British Institute of Physics, the Lars Onsager Prize from the American Physical Society. He is fellow of the American Physical Society and the American Academy of Arts and Sciences. and since 2017, he has been elected member of the National Academy of Sciences. But more importantly, in 2016, he was awarded the Nobel Prize in Physics, together with David Thouless and Duncan Haldane, for quoting theoretical discoveries of topological phase transitions and topological phases of matter. So before we start, let me just remind you that you will be able to ask questions, and I encourage you to ask a lot of questions, but you will be able to do that at the end of the talk. After the talk, you will have to raise your hand in the Zoom application. You will find a small blue hand in the bottom right corner, and clicking on it, you will be put in a queue and you will be able to ask your questions at the end. Okay, so now without further ado, let me give the floor to Professor Kosterlitz, who will tell us about topological defects and phase transitions in two dimensions. Please.
Yes, thank you very much for that very flattering introduction. And the title of my talk, as you can see, is, you notice there's two titles. There's the official technical title, Topological Defects and Phase Transitions in Two Dimensions. And then underneath is the alternative title called A Random Walk Through Physics. And my slides cover both talks. So if something technical appears, don't worry about it, because I intend to concentrate more on the second part and tell the story of how I happen to get involved in some important physics, or physics that turned out to be later on important. So let me try to, okay. And, you know, I ended up in, you know, to my great surprise in 2016, being awarded the Nobel Prize in Physics, and these, with the other two physicists, there's me on the left, there's Thouless in the middle, who's the main character, and then there's Duncan Haldane. Because, you know, when I was incredibly pleased when I got the information that I won the Nobel Prize. That was wonderful. And then a bit later on, I discovered that I learned how the prize money was split up. And what happened was that Thouless got half, and the other half was shared between Duncan Haldane and myself. And I thought, hey, that's not fair. It should be a third each. Then I thought a little bit, and then I realized that actually the Nobel Committee was much smarter than I was, because actually the division was very fair, because really the prize was given by two very different but related pieces of work, because Thouless and I had worked on the classical aspects of topology and related to phase transitions, but then a little bit later, Thouless left Birmingham and went to the States and worked on topology and quantum mechanics, which eventually led to the discovery of, topological insulators. And Duncan Haldane was also worked on and important things on topological insulators. The Thouless, of course, had worked on both aspects. And so when I thought, you know, as I said, I thought about it and I realized that this is very fair, because a quarter of the prize was given for, no, half the prize was given to Thouless and myself for work on classical stuff. And the other half was given to Thouless and Haldane for the quantum stuff, the application of topology to quantum mechanics. So it was very fair, because, you know, two separate pieces of work, two authors on each piece of work. But so quart to each author because of, you know, four people involved. But of course, this violated one of the rules of the Nobel Prize, which was a maximum of three people. But fortunately, one of the people in each piece of work was the same person, David Thouless, so he got half. So, you know, when I figured that out, it was a very, very fair distribution of money. And so just to confirm that actually was at the Nobel ceremony, I thought I'd throw this photograph, this picture in. In the middle is my wife and myself, surrounded by the Swedish royal family. This was taken in 2016. So I have proof that I was actually there. Now, okay. So let me tell us a little bit of the story how I ended up doing what I did. And this really started quite a long time ago here, because this is a picture of my father and myself. Myself as a rather young boy outside our granite house in a little village outside Aberdeen in Scotland. And even from a very young age, I got sort of interested in technical things. You know, at school, I enjoyed mathematics and science, because they were reasonably logical subjects. And so I could get by without doing much work by remembering, you know, just a few facts, like half a dozen facts. And then I could more or less work out everything from those half dozen facts. The humanities on the other hand, things like literature, history, geography, and so on, I found very difficult because there was too many facts to remember. And my memory, as I said, is never very good. So I always had trouble with subjects like that. But I was lucky because I went through the British educational system back in the 50s and 60s. And because I found that I could drop the subjects I didn't like at age 16. So by age 16, I could drop all the things like literature, languages and so on, and I didn't have to do them anymore. And I could concentrate on what I enjoyed. In other words, maths and science. And so actually, of the sciences, the thing that I really liked the most was chemistry, because chemistry was fun. Physics and things were a little bit dull and boring, but they were still okay. Now, of course, I went to Cambridge. I ended up at Cambridge University because my father decided that I seemed to be reasonably bright and I should be able to get into Cambridge. So I did. And at Cambridge, I got my downfall started because I discovered the sport of climbing mountains, and particularly rock climbing, which I found I seemed to have a talent for that. And I really enjoyed climbing cliffs because they gave me the thrill and excitement I really craved. You know, there's nothing quite like stepping out, being out in the middle of nowhere on a big cliff somewhere, and you know you're entirely on your own, and you have to find your own way on this big cliff. And the penalties for mistakes were fairly, could be quite serious. I mean, they were up to and including death for a mistake. So it gave a sort of new meaning to living and, or rather, the surviving. And I really enjoyed that. Now, I had this, so trouble, but the only trouble with this newfound sport was that it absorbed an incredible amount of time. And my academic studies suffered a little bit, more than a bit, because I remember, I think it was 5 weeks before the final exam in Cambridge. The weather was beautiful, so I decided rather than continuing to revise, I would take off and go rock climbing because the weather was good. And so, of course, when I came to sit down for the final exam, I really didn't know very much because, you know, during the semester, I had taken off and gone climbing instead of going to lectures. And at the end of the day, I, you know, 5 weeks before the exam, the final exam, I really didn't know even what the syllabus was. So I sort of ran around all my friends asking, can I borrow some, you know, have you got some lecture notes? Could I borrow them? And so I managed to borrow enough to, and read them and thought, my God, I haven't heard of any of this stuff. I've left things a bit late. And so I didn't do as well as I was supposed to in the final exam, because, you know, I was expected to come out with a first class degree, but not knowing very much, I didn't manage that and ended up with a lower degree. Now, I started life, when I was a graduate student and a postdoc, I was a high energy graduate student. But of course, in those days, I worked on what are called dual resonance models or the Veneziano model, which I believe were precursors to modern string theory. And so I was doing a PhD at Oxford and I was getting very, very bored. And then I went to Torino as a postdoc and continued doing my high energy calculations and wrote the odd paper, which had probably never been read, but that's beside the point. And but when I was in Italy, I'd spent most of my time skiing with my girlfriend, or rather, who's now my wife. And then at the end of the winter, I started getting desperate to go climbing. And so I eventually managed to meet some of the young climbers from Torino, who mostly worked at Fiat. And of course, really helped me to learn Italian, because the only way of communicating with my climbing friends was using my rather primitive grasp of Italian. And it's amazingly difficult to communicate in a language that you don't know well when you're on a cliff in a wind. Because, you know, if you're around the corner of the rock in a wind, communicating with your partner is not easy, because you have to shout loudly and the words get all distorted by the wind and so on. And so communicating with my climbing partners was not easy, but we didn't managed, not processed. And then, okay. One day in when we were in Toronto, my partner was driving up to a valley, the Orco, Val d'Orco, in a bit north of Torino, and driving this very narrow road. And we drove past a boulder at the side of the road. And on the right there of this picture is the boulder. And I saw, and as we were driving past it, I happened to see this, in this gently overhanging face, a very narrow crack running up it. So I yelled, stop the car, in my best Italian. And I jumped out, put on my climbing shoes, and managed to climb up this crack, which was quite hard. But I had done more difficult things, but none of my climbing partners could do this. And it turned out that this crack was not repeated for something like 10 years, at least that's what I was told. Of course, these days, it's climbed all the time because it's become quite a test piece for some up and coming climber. And there are many, many more difficult routes in Italy than this thing. But apparently for a number of years, climbers used to come from all over to try this test piece crack. And some of them didn't, some of them couldn't do it. You see, it was about 6 meters high enough to possibly hurt yourself if you fell off. I heard that one guy got to his hands to the top and couldn't get over the top and fell down and broke a leg. But I managed to get up without hurting myself. I was very lucky. Now, so let's change gears now and go on to talk about my physics rather than my rock climbing adventures. And so there's a picture of somebody actually climbing up the crack. And so you can see it looks quite steep and quite difficult. I doubt that I could do it. I could manage this thing these days. I'm far too old and fat to do that sort of thing anymore. Oh yeah, so let's go back to the physics. Now, when I was at Torino as a high energy physicist, the next place I wanted to go to was CERN in Geneva. So that was the natural place to go after Torino. It's also CERN has got some good physics and excellent mountains nearby, so it was the obvious place to go next. But of course, unfortunately, as is my usual mode of operation, I sent in my application to CERN a bit late and got the reply, sorry, all the desk space is gone, apply next year. So I now faced unemployment because I was so sure that I was going to be able to go to CERN in Geneva that I hadn't bothered applying to anywhere else. And so my girlfriend, who's now my wife, looked at me and called me a few uncomplimentary names and walked down to the railway station Torino, about a kilometer and a half, and bought an English newspaper at the railway station because the English newspaper had academic job advertisements in it. Came back to the apartment, sat me down at the kitchen table, open the newspaper at the advertisements, point them, and said, apply. So I did. I applied for, I don't know, half a dozen jobs in Britain, and was offered one or two. And very reluctantly accepted a two-year postdoc at Birmingham University. Now, Birmingham is a big industrial city in the flat middle of England, miles and miles away from any mountains. And so this was a place, the last place in the world that I wanted to be in. But I didn't have much choice because I needed a job, and so actually just before I went to Birmingham, I got another letter from CERN which said that, okay, they changed their minds. They were going to have two people per office rather than just one. And so there was space. And so I could come to CERN. And I was all set to renege on my offer from Birmingham and spend the next year at CERN. But my wife and my father were of the opinion that really this was not the thing to do, because since I'd signed the contract, I was obliged to go to Birmingham. Now, I fought and lost the battle with both of them, my father and my wife, and went to Birmingham. Now, of course, at the end of the day, this was the best thing that could have happened to me, because it was in Birmingham where, after a year of doing absurd calculation in high energy physics and being having a group in Berkeley, California, publish exactly what I was trying to do, just before I was sat down to write up my calculations, and then the preprint would arrive in my desk doing exactly what I was going to do. And this happened twice. You know, once was okay, I could put up with that because things like that happen. But 2 months later, exactly the same thing happened. So I threw up my hands and said, I just can't compete here, because I was on my own in this little office in Birmingham, and I was competing with a group in Berkeley, California, and I just couldn't compete with them. So I started walking around the departments in Birmingham, asking every faculty member I could find, do you by any chance have a problem that I could maybe look at? And the general answer was, no, I'm sorry. And eventually I found myself in David Thouless' office. Now, my colleagues in Birmingham all said that they found David Thouless a very difficult person to talk to, because, you know, they just didn't have anything in common with David. But I was sort of pretty desperate by this point. And so I thought, okay, I will, you know, beard the lion in his den and see if what he has to say. And I was standing in David's office, listening to him talking about some problem. And he was writing on the blackboard, equation after equation. And I was completely lost. I had no idea what was happening. And so eventually I thought, this is ridiculous. I've got to stop him because I have no idea what he's talking about, and he's wasting his time, I'm wasting my time. So I plucked up my courage and said, David, sorry, could you stop for a moment? I'm sorry, I don't understand anything you're talking about. So I'm completely lost. Could you please tell me, where did the first equation you wrote on the board, where did that come from? And he turned around and looked at me and said, didn't I tell you that? And I could honestly say, no, you didn't. And he sort of said, oh, and then proceeded to start from the beginning and give a very clear explanation of what, you know, what he was talking about. And from that point on, we actually got on pretty well together, very well together, because I decided that next time I didn't understand, which certainly would be frequent, because you see, Thouless was one of these people who I think could be fairly called a genius, because Thouless knew everything about everything. And he seemed to have a mind or a brain which operated on a different level to everybody else. And so Thouless had, you know, very few people could understand David. And I think my own personal view is that was because Thouless is probably more intelligent than, smarter than almost everybody else. But he didn't realize that he was so much smarter than other people. So he would talk to people as if they were on his level, with the result that the person he was talking to couldn't understand a word he was saying. And so, but I decided that next time I don't understand what he's talking about, which was, as I said, going to be frequent, I would assume it was because he had not explained something properly. And so I used this attitude to pluck up courage and ask stupid questions. And it seemed that Thouless actually liked this, that he actually answered all these questions patiently and clearly. And so from that point on, we actually got on well together, because I had lost my fear of asking him questions. Now, so one day I was in his office talking about some problem. David was interested in actually solving the problem of a two-dimensional Coulomb gas. And I thought, okay, sounds interesting. Why on earth would you want to look at this problem? You know, the interaction between, you know, a pair of charges in two dimensions, which interact with the Coulomb, interacting the Coulomb interaction, which of course in two dimensions is the log, you know, the logarithm of the separation. So, but why on earth is this an interesting problem? And so David pointed out this little picture here. This is a picture from a Physicist of Letters from 1972, but of course the picture that David was pointing, was showing me, was from a preprint, because this was 1971. And he pointed out that, look, this is a picture of the experiment consisted of a resonant crystal with an adsorbed layer of helium-4 on it. You know, the layer was, I don't know, a few, you know, one or two, three, four atomic thicknesses. And one might expect the natural interpretation of this plot of this is the change in frequency in the vertical axis versus the coverage of helium, the horizontal axis. And what happens is that when you, if the film is very thin, the film of helium on the crystal is very thin, you'd expect that every atom of the helium on the on this crystal is stuck to the crystal, you know, absorbed onto the surface, and it's a very thin layer, 2-3 atomic layers thick, and so you'd expect this all to be stuck to the surface of the crystal, and if the surface of the crystal moves, you'd expect all the absorbed atoms to move with the crystal. And so this was a very simple experiment by Marvin Chester and co-workers, where they measured the change in the resonant frequency of the crystal, the vertical axis, which is just the negative of the change in frequency, versus the coverage. And you'd expect that the change in the frequency would be proportional to the coverage of helium, because on the assumption that the helium just adds to the mass of the oscillating crystal, and therefore will just simply decrease the resonant frequency. And that is, so that is the solid line. That's the classical prediction that, you know, assuming that the adsorbed film is stuck to the surface of the crystal and moves with it. And so everything looks fine for low coverages, but you can see that the horizontal axis is proportional to the amount of helium adsorbed on the crystal surface. And so we see that the experimental points, the points follow, you know, come up to this the classical straight line and follow the straight line for a bit as the coverage increases, which is exactly what you expect classically. But then there's this strange phenomenon that suddenly the experimental dots, you know, so this is done at constant temperature and increasing coverage, that the experimental points suddenly break away from the predicted straight line. And the experimental points all follow some curve, which is well below the classical straight line. And so clearly something's happened. And so the question, because the experiment says, look, what's happened is some of the adsorbed fluid is no longer moving with the crystal, but seems to have got decoupled from the crystal. Now, remember, this is a thin layer of 2-3 atomic layers of helium on the surface of the crystal. And so the only way of interpreting the discrepancy between the straight line, the expected straight line, and the experimental points is, as I said, to say that some of the helium has decoupled from the crystal. And how do we interpret this decoupling? Well, really the only way, well, one of the only ways that I'm going to interpret this is to say that some of the film of helium has gone superfluid, and it's well known that a superfluid decouples from the substrate, or at least from the experimental apparatus, and flows according to its own rules, independent of what the experimental apparatus is doing. But there's a problem here, because theory makes some statements about superfluid in two dimensions. And what the theory says is, the first thing is that in any two-dimensional system, at non-zero temperature, there is no long-range order. Okay, now you ask yourself, okay, what does this mean? Well, if you write down the magnetic analog of the superfluid film, which exists, and there's no question this analog is right, that in a two-dimensional magnet with the right symmetry, continuous symmetry, there is no long-range order at any non-finite temperature. Now, this is a rigorous mathematical theorem. Okay, so good. So we have a system. So the experimental system is one in which there's no long-range order, which is a big theoretical problem, because the standard interpretation of a superfluid at the time was that there has to be long-range order, because a phase transition from a normal fluid to a superfluid, according to Landau, says that the ordered phase is distinguished from the disordered high temperature phase, in that an ordered phase has to have long-range order. That is the rule laid down by the god of phase transitions, Lev Landau. But you see, the theory says, in two dimensions, there is no long-range order in the system. Therefore, there is this apparent conflict between theory and experiment, because this theory is rigorous, and it's certainly applicable to the two-dimensional helium film. There is no long-range order. So therefore, according to the interpretation of Landau, which is accepted by all physicists, is that there's no phase transition in this two-dimensional film of helium. But experiment says, okay, here's the data, something happens, come on. It's obvious that something's going on. And so there's this conflict between theory and experiment. Because experiment says, look, there's a perfectly good phase transition in this two-dimensional film, which we can all see from this data. But rigorous theory combined with the interpretation of Lev Landau is that there is no phase transition. So how can this film be superfluid? And so really what Dave and I did was we reconciled this apparent conflict. Because what Dave and I said was, look, okay, we have this transition in this two-dimensional XY model, which is a model for superfluidity in a two-dimensional helium film. Now, for those of you who are saying this film isn't really two-dimensional, of course you're right. I mean, after all, it's 2-3 atomic layers thick. But if you've got a film of lateral size of order, let's say several millimeters is much bigger than a couple of atomic thicknesses. So to all intents and purposes, this film is a perfectly respectable two-dimensional system. So this was the problem that Dave and I sat down to think about. And so, you know, after this, you know, after talking to David, I went back to my own office and started thinking. And because David gave me this, gave me a preprint by Phil Anderson and Gideon Yuval, who solved a one-dimensional system of an Ising model in one dimension, but with a 1 over r squared interaction. And they solved it by this very strange method. Of course, being, which actually this method was the precursor, was the first renormalization group treatment of any system. And so, you know, I feel that really Phil Anderson and Yuval should have got the got a prize for inventing the renormalization group rather than Ken Wilson, but that's beside the point because so I actually learned my renormalization group from Phil Anderson's paper. And so I thought that maybe Anderson's method is applicable to a two-dimensional system. Because we made the, I think, quite understandable mistake of thinking that the most important thing is the fact that both systems involved a logarithmically interacting point objects. And so in two dimensions, the obvious point object interacting with a logarithmic interaction are point vortices in helium, because certainly these are, you know, points, the vortex centers are, you know, points, and they interact with each other with a logarithmically with a separation. And so I applied Anderson's renormalization group to this problem, and to my surprise, it actually worked. And in the inset of the of this little graph are the actual equations, the fundamental equations of the system, where this K is basically interaction with a 1 over, it's inversely proportional to temperature. And the Y is called the fugacity of a vortex. It's related to the probability of a vortex being present in the system. And so if I assumed that the vortex fugacity is very small, in other words, it's a very dilute system of vortices, I could work out some renormalization group equations for the fugacity and the interaction. And so this little L in those equations is related to the scaling of the short distance cutoff, or if you like, the vortex core size. You know, the vortex core size is the shortest distance. And so when you scale the size of the core, call it A, to A e to the L, then you end up with some equations relating the interaction strength at any length scale to the fugacity of the vortex probability at the same length scale. And those are the renormalization group equations. And actually these two simple equations contain all the physics of the problem. And so when we plot the solutions to these equations, we get these lines with the arrows, and the arrows are in the direction increasing L. And what these mean is that these tell you how the vortex fugacity Y, the vertical axis, and the interaction constant, the horizontal axis, are related to each other with, at all length scales given by this parameter L. And so we see that, so for large K, we're at low temperatures, and small K, we're at higher temperatures. And so the bottom right-hand corner of this graph corresponds to a region where the interaction constant is large and low, small temperature, and the fugacity is small. And so what happens is that as we increase the length scale, the fugacity changes and goes to zero at very long length scales. And at high temperatures, we see that the fugacity starts decreasing and then starts growing. And so we can interpret, so a zero fugacity phase, we can interpret as a system with no vortices. And a system with a two-dimensional system with no vortices is obviously a superfluid, because the only thing that can destroy superfluidity are vortices. And so since there are no vortices at low temperatures, it must be a superfluid. On the other hand, there's the other region where the vortex fugacity grows with increasing length scale, so that the fugacity Y gets bigger and bigger. And this phase has to be interpreted as a phase with vortices. And the interpretation of that is that's a normal phase, because after all, the only thing that can cause dissipation of superfluid is the presence of vortices. And so what distinguishes a normal phase from a superfluid phase is the normal phase has got no, the superfluid phase has no vortices, and the normal fluid phase has vortices. And so this little calculation should tell you that at low temperatures, there's no vortices. At a special temperature, the straight line with separating the decreasing fugacity phase and the increasing fugacity phase, that should be the critical temperature as a function of the fugacity. And the other flows tell you that this must be the high temperature phase. So if you do a little bit more calculations, the crucial prediction of our theory are that the measured stiffness constant, which is related to the measured superfluid density, the physical value, which is depends on the physical interaction and fugacity, is equal to the renormalized stiffness constant, which is again proportional to the superfluid density, as a function of the renormalized interactions and fugacity. So that this little equation leads to an immediate prediction of the superfluid density, because the stiffness constant is proportional to the superfluid density, which is superfluid mass per unit area, multiplied by various fundamental constants. So this is equal to this renormalized stiffness constant, which is given in terms of physical parameters, but the renormalization calculation tells you this is equal to the renormalized, it's equal to the same quantity calculated with the fugacity and interaction, calculated L equals infinity, but at low temperatures and at TC, the fugacity at infinite length scale is zero. Therefore, this renormalized superfluid stiffness constant is just given by the interaction constant scaled at L equals infinity, but the renormalization calculation tells you that at TC, this is exactly 2/π. And if we're below TC, it is plus something proportional to basically the square root of T of the deviation from critical the critical temperature for if we're below the TC, and of course it's zero at above TC. And therefore, if you're just below TC, the superfluid density divided by the critical temperature is given by this set of fundamental constants. You know, you've got mass of the helium atom, Boltzmann constant, and H cross. And this works out at about 3.5 times 10 to the minus 9, I'm sorry, that minus 8 should be a minus 9 grams per centimeter squared per degree Kelvin. And the question, this is the prediction. If this can be measured, in other words, the ratio of the superfluid density per unit area just below the critical temperature divided by TC, if this quantity can be measured experimentally, it should be equal to this number, and there's no way around it. And so the theory stands or falls with this prediction. And, oops. Now, there we are. The experiment was actually done by Bishop and Reppy in 1978, at least published in 1978. And these various points on this graph are the experimental measurements of the superfluid density as a function of temperature, at the critical point. And the points were all measured before the Bishop and Reppy were actually aware of the prediction by David Thouless and myself. And so imagine these points, they plotted these points, but they didn't have the straight line. And so you saw this set of points, you would say, well, other than the scatter, maybe that looks like a straight line. And then somebody said to these two guys, Kosterlitz and Thouless, they have actually calculated the slope of the straight line. So why don't you put that on your plot? And so they did. And our prediction, because our prediction measures the slope of that straight line. That's our universal prediction, and which is called the universal jump in the superfluid density. And so the agreement between theory and experiment looks quite good to me. You know, I leave it up to the audience to decide whether they believe that this data confirms our prediction or not, but we take it as a confirmation. It seems that the Nobel Committee also took this data as a good confirmation. And I'll show one more slide. The theory was based entirely on the properties of the array of vortices in a superfluid, because it's the vortices which and their interactions which determine the superfluid transition, whether a system is superfluid or not. And the same sort of arguments can be made for a two-dimensional crystal in two dimensions. You know, if you think of the theory of melting in two dimensions, the objects which will melt a two-dimensional crystal are dislocations. And so the absence of the dislocation dislocation says you've got a two-dimensional crystal, but if you've got free dislocations floating around in the crystal, then this system will respond to a shear like a liquid, because the dislocation, if there are free dislocations and the present under the influence of a shear, the crystal will deform like a fluid, and the shear modulus will be zero. But then in the crystal, the shear modulus must be finite. And so the analogous prediction for the dislocation problem is the renormalized Young's modulus, which is some combination of elastic constants and versus the temperature. And so if you're below the melting temperature, the Young's modulus is non-zero. And it should, the dislocation theory of melting is right, this Young's modulus should go down to some universal value of about 50, to be precise, 16 pi, just below Tc, and be zero above Tc. And we see that. So this is a comparison between theory and experiment. Experiments were done on layers of colloidal particles on the surface of air-water interface. And the points with the experimental errors are the experimental points. And the red line is a prediction from the renormalization group as applied to the dislocations. And the melting happens when the Young's modulus is about 50. And the red line, so you can say that this, the agreement between theory and experiment is pretty good. And so this is regarded as experimental confirmation of the theory of melting. Now, so the conclusion is that Now, let me just finish by making a few remarks to finish this talk. I'd like to thank David Thouless, who unfortunately died in 2019, for introducing me to this beautiful problem. David Nelson for collaboration and discussions, John Reppy for many useful discussions, and of course the Nobel Committee for the recognition. I must thank my wife, Barrett, for an incredible journey through life, taking us from Birmingham to Providence, and finally, but not least, my children, Karen, Jonathan, and Elizabeth, for putting up with their very strange father and his habits. So thank you very much for your attention, and I hope you learn something. Thank you very much.
So thank you very much for describing all these beautiful physics, and also for sharing with us those interesting memories about your life. So now we can have questions. So if you want to ask a question, you can raise your hand, just say from the bottom right corner of the Zoom app, there is a blue hand, and you can ask your question, or if you prefer, you can write it in the Q&A chat. Okay, so we have a question from Amogavarsha. So you should be able to speak.
Hello.
Okay, I hear you.
Hello, sir.
Hi.
My question was, means now I'm in master's, but I'm little confused. Means I'm struggling between the marks and the marks of the college and the semester and my interest. So what is your suggestion for students like me who are in their courses and struggling between these two?
Well, okay.
Hope my question was clear.
I don't like to give any explicit recommendations because everybody is different. And my only real recommendation is, look, you guys are still pretty young. You've got lots of time in front of you. So you should study what you enjoy. Because after all, if you do something that you don't enjoy, it's not worth doing it. So you should study what gives you pleasure and have fun with it. Because if you're not having fun with what you're doing, it's not worth doing. So my main suggestion or advice is have fun.
Okay, so there is another question in the chat, and they ask if you can explain in simple terms why there is no conventional long-range order in two-dimensional systems.
That's pretty simple. It's because the fluctuations in two dimensions are so much more violent than three dimensions that the fluctuations are large enough so that they will destroy the long-range order. But the only just destroyed, do you see what I mean? So, you know, and a two-dimensional system with the continuous symmetry is on the verge of having long-range order. If you take your system, imagine you have a magnet in two dimensions, you know, X, Y, or plane and rotor magnet, where the atomic magnetic moments can point in any direction in the plane. And you imagine looking at a small piece of the system. The interaction likes to line these atomic moments, make them all parallel. It's a ferromagnet. And so if I look at a small piece of my system, it's basically going to look pretty much ordered. You know, all the atomic magnets are going to be pointing roughly almost in the same direction, but there will be fluctuations, there will be deviations. And it's only when you look at when you make the system bigger and bigger and bigger that these fluctuations become enough to destroy the long-range order, in the sense that if you look at the correlation in the direction of the spin, if you take one spin somewhere in the system and you take another spin along, you know, distant r away, you know, a lot, which is big compared to the lattice spacing, this spin will be pointing in some other direction. But there will be some correlation between these directions. And this is measured by the so-called two-point correlation function, which in two dimensions falls off like a power law, like one over the distance to some power which is less than a quarter. Whereas if there were long-range order, this at infinite separations, this correlation function will be proportional to the square of the magnetization. You see, the difference between this correlation function in two dimensions and higher dimensions is not great. It's just that in two dimensions, this correlation function falls off like a power law. And in three dimensions, it'll fall off basically the same way, just very similar way, except in three dimensions, below the critical temperature, it will have a you know, a constant contribution, proportion squared of the magnetization. So if you think about it that way, there's not that much difference.
Okay, thank you. There is another question from Junik Sengupta. So you can ask your question. You should unmute yourself. Hello? Yes.
Hello?
Am I audible?
Yes.
Thank you, sir. First of all, I would like to thank you for this awesome lecture. That was very nice and that was very much motivating. So thanks a lot. Yes?
Yes, you can go on. Can I ask your question?
My question was that how does spin pairing make you immune to attraction? Or...
Sorry, how does what theory? I'm sorry, spin theory.
Thank you.
Remember this.
How does spin pairing make you immune to attraction or repulsion from bulk surfaces as related to superfluidity?
So perhaps I'm being a bit stupid here, so I didn't quite understand what you're asking.
Actually, what I wanted to ask is that the spin pairing of these atoms, like the we know the spin quantum numbers and there are two atoms, and how come their spin pairing make them immune to attraction or repulsion from bulk surfaces?
Okay, so let me. Perhaps I didn't make myself clear enough. The theory that Thouless and I constructed was about a purely classical system, no quantum mechanics in it. Oh, there is quantum mechanics, but it's basically purely classical physics. We assume that there is some object, you know, which we'd call a spin, which has got the spin S is proportional to, you know, the e to the I theta with theta some the angle of the spin, so that you know, it's a two component animal. But otherwise, it's the only bit of quantum mechanics we put in. Is, you know, was in the helium, so the theory of superfluidity, because the only piece of theory we have, you know, quantum mechanics you put in, is that the ground state wave function is a complex field, and that's it. Otherwise, everything's classical.
Okay. Thanks a lot.
That spin is a pure classical object.
So actually, maybe I can ask also a question. So in your title, you had the word topological. There was topological defects and so on. So maybe can you expand a little bit about the meaning of this word?
When I did the work, I barely knew, I'd heard the word topology, but I had no idea what it really meant. And so I was looking at this problem from the point of view of statistical mechanics, where, and configuration of the system. And so to me, the important configurations of that we had to look at were the configurations that were responsible for the destruction of superfluidity. Now, if I take a two-dimensional film at low temperatures, it's going to be a superfluid. And the question is, what excitations will destroy the superfluidity? And the only excitations that can destroy superfluidity are vortices. Because if I take a pair of, you know, a pair of a vortex, anti-vortex pair, they're certainly going to be there, you know, close together. I take a close pair, they've got, you know, I've got an object with zero vorticity. And so the influence doesn't, you know, of this object doesn't go very far from, you know, it's basically local. But if I separate the vortex and the anti-vortex, and of course they will separate according to the rules of statistical mechanics, because it depends on the energy of that configuration, right? And so at finite temperatures, they will tend to separate. And at a particular temperature, the pre-existing largest pair will become infinitely far apart. And when they're infinitely far apart, you have to regard them as free and able to move. And if I have free vortices which can move around, these will make any imposed superfluid velocity, superfluid flow, unstable. It will destroy it. So therefore, the presence or otherwise of superfluidity is determined by the properties of the vortices. And that was the reason. And the vortices, now at the time, the vortices, as David Thouless kindly pointed out to me, can be regarded as topological excitations, because a vortex is like, okay, imagine a superfluid film. And then put a couple of vortices on it in there. These vortices, the center of the vortex corresponds to a hole in my superfluid. It's just a little piece of normal fluid, right? It's the vortex core, and the rest of the fluid is circulating about this normal core. And if I measure the change in the phase of the superfluid order parameters, I walk around this vortex, it changes by a multiple of 2 pi. That's the topology. That's all it is.
Thank you. So, I have another question from the chat. Anil Pudasaini asks, what is the difference between the superfluidity and superconductivity in simple terms?
In principle, none. Because in two dimensions, you can say that a superconducting system is a superfluid phase of the electrons or the Cooper pairs. And so from this point of view, there's no difference between the superconducting system and the superfluid helium system, except for one major difference, and that is that the superfluid in the superconducting system is charged, because the electrons carry charge. And so if you calculate the interaction between a pair, you know, vortices in a superfluid, beg your pardon, a superconductor, they also interact logarithmically, just like the vortices in a superfluid helium. But there's this extra wrinkle that there's a so-called penetration depth in a superfluid because the fact is charged. And this penetration depth measures the distance out to which the logarithmic interaction between the vortices works. if you go to further, if you set go beyond this penetration length, the interaction falls off like a inverse power of the separation. I can't remember, 1/r or 1/r². It doesn't really matter. But if you have a system of point particles interacting with any interaction that falls off faster than the logarithm of the separation, there's no phase transition. You know, it's always disordered. And so that is the essential difference between a two-dimensional superfluid and two-dimensional superconductor, is that in principle, in a two-dimensional superconductor, there's no true superconductivity in two dimensions. In an infinite-sized system. But of course, an experimental two-dimensional superconductor is always finite. And if you're at separations less than the screening length or penetration depth length, there is superfluidity, there is superconductivity. Remember that superconductivity is a scale-dependent quantity, because suppose I take a system of size L, and I want to measure the correlation in the phase of the order parameter at a length scale L. In a true superfluid, this is basically a logarithmic quantity. It's essentially perfect correlation. But in a superfluid, at separations larger than the penetration depth length, this correlation falls off faster than, you know, it falls off like an inverse power. And so in principle, there is no superconductivity at an infinite system. But of course, an experimental system, you know, this penetration depth in a two-dimensional superconductor is actually pretty big. It can easily be as large as a centimeter, which is bigger than any experimental system in two dimensions. You can't have a two-dimensional superconductor of a centimeter by a centimeter. That's impossible. You can't make it. And so the experiments all carried out short length scales. And so this long length scale statement that superconductivity is actually can't exist in two dimensions, Rick, is not true. It's purely an effect due to basic superconductivity in two dimensions, basically a finite size effect. But the length scale of the finite size effect is huge in two dimensions. And so for all practical purposes, superconductivity exists in two dimensions.
Thank you. So there are a couple of questions which are on related topics. So let me try to put them together. Essentially, they ask about the dependence on the dimensionality. So somebody asks, okay, can you compress the system and learn something about one-dimensional systems, or what about three dimensions? So how much dimensionality plays a role here?
Okay, well, dimensionality actually plays a huge role. Two dimensions is a system that's right on the borderline of having a phase transition in the Landau sense and not having a phase transition. You see, if I take a short range, you know, take short range interactions, if I were to go to 2+ epsilon dimensions, if I could you know, extrapolate in dimensionality. So to go just to take a hypothetical system, mathematical system, which is slightly more than two-dimensional, then it will have a standard phase transition in such a system. There will be long-range order. But then if I go to 1.9 dimensions, just below two dimensions, there's no long-range order. It's short-ranged. And two dimensions, exactly the borderline case. So things are very special in two dimensions because there's a special dimension. You know, you're right at the so-called lower critical dimension where all sorts of peculiar things can happen. And of course they do. So, I mean, in that sense, dimension plays a very essential role. Two dimensions is very special. But it just so happens that two dimensions is experimentally accessible, which makes things very pretty. You know, if you take a, for example, if you take a Wilson type normalization group calculation and work out what happens in exactly four dimensions, which is the so-called upper critical dimensionality for a conventional phase transition, then what you get then is you get all sorts of wonderful logarithmic corrections to the conventional critical behavior. So if the world could, you know, if experiments could be done in four space dimensions and do accurate experiments, you would be able to measure these weird and wonderful logarithmic corrections, which are in fact exact and universal. It's just that unfortunately it's not accessible. But the lower critical dimension of two is accessible. And so we can actually do experiments in it. And the other reason of, you know, why two dimensions are special is that it's possible to use the renormalization group to make some exact predictions. You see, for example, the prediction of this universal value of the ratio of the superfluid density just, you know, below TC divided by the critical temperature as being some number, you know, given by some fundamental constants, that prediction is exact. I mean, there's no way of changing that number. So if you do an experiment to measure that number and it comes out different to the prediction, the theoretical prediction, then the whole theory is wrong. So two dimensions is very, very special. And we're just lucky that two dimensions is experimentally accessible. I hope that's answers your question, at least to some extent.
I think it does. So maybe we have time for one last question. So let me pick one from the chat. Well, it's a question which is not immediately related to your talk, but I think it might be an interesting one. So they ask, what are the challenges of making superconductors at room temperature?
They're very big. Yes. And I would say that it's a matter of trying to find a material in which the interactions between the superconducting object, you know, the objects responsible for superconductivity, is large enough, and the system with the fluctuations are small enough so that temperature doesn't destroy it. Of course, I have no idea what material may give one room temperature superconductor. A lot of progress has been made. If I think what's the highest temperature people found? 100 degrees Kelvin, something like that. It's about the highest temperature superconductor, which is, who knows? Maybe it's possible to eventually find a room temperature superconductor. But it's a materials problem. And I have no idea about, you know, I'm not a material scientist, except I know that at the present time, there is no known material which will give you superconductivity at that higher temperature.
Okay, thank you very much. So I think now it's time to thank Professor Kosterlitz for this beautiful lecture and answering to all these questions. And also thank to all the attendees for participating to the colloquium.
So thank you. I hope you enjoy. I hope you, if you didn't enjoy it, you'd at least learn something.
Thank you. And I think there is a session with students right now.
Right, thank you.
Francesco.
Yes. So there will be now private session with the students, Professor Kosterlitz. So you will have to connect to the other link, and you will have the session with the other students.
So I have somewhere, I've got an email for this other link, do I?
Yes.
Okay, I'll have to find that.
But okay, so let me close this session.
Bye-bye.
Bye now, thank you very much.
Bye-bye.
Thank you very much once again.